Bite, 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 bite. Ready, James? Bother, 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 bite, 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 bite.
You're just poking the box. You're not really poking my head.
Let's do this.
There can be only one.
They're here.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Cinema Royale.
Hello, welcome to Cinema Royale. Thank you. Thank you.
And we're off to a great start. Welcome to Cinema Royale.
Welcome to the podcast, people, because we try to keep it classy most of the time, and that's the most unclassy thing we ever done so far. Off to a great start, folks. I'm your host, Mike Mixtape. Let me introduce you to the brotherhood slash sisterhood of cinema here. So first off, we got James Sullivan, also known as Jaime, dude.
Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by... How shall I put this? Mike's Underwear Movies.
Brought to you by Captain Underpants coming this June?
No.
Exactly.
No. Basically, it was a case where he was talking about underwater films, but it came out as underwear, and we were all so excited to have knicker talk. But
you,
damn.
You had
Maybe
to,
you were.
You had to explain it. Thank you, Steph. Thank you for the viewers. Next.
You're welcome.
Right next to James is Matt Bruneos, knows that, Matt.
What's up, everybody? I'm the one, as you may know, who is keeping it classy here. I'm the one who is responsible for holding on to the dignity of Cinema Royale.
Oh, and last but not least, Steph Felton.
Heidi, hi, campers.
Heidi, heidi, ho.
Just making a reference to a 70s program in the UK that these guys will go woo-hoo-hoo over their heads, but what the hey. So yeah, I was thinking to myself a moment ago, like, something's missing. And I realise what it is. It's something fluffy and it goes moo.
Oh!
Fluffy and it goes moo.
You want to do a fluffy cow update? Let me find a fluffy cow! Today's broadcast is also by a fluffy cow.
Oh, what about the tiny fluffy cow that I showed you ages ago? Fluffball, our mascot.
Fluffy cow.
Fluffy cow, fluffy cow. What brush are they using?
Yes.
As weird as you were doing the intro, the cat was just banging at the door. So yeah.
Oh, the cat wants it. There we go. The fluffy cow is back.
There we go. The
fluffy cow is back. You gotta make
the
rough.
Fluffy cow.
There we go. Now this episode's complete because this is a revisit to films from our birth year. Since this is Cinema Royale's fourth year anniversary, we go back and talk about films from our birth year. Just, look at other stuff from our birth year. We talked about a lot last time, and I'll link that video at the end of this episode, so if you want to check that out, you can check that out. But we're going from youngest to oldest this time, because last time we did oldest to youngest, so why don't we start with Steph Felton?
Thank you. Right, as some people may not know, or may know from my channel, I was born in 1993. Well, 17th of July, 1993, to be honest. And basically, on that day, the world was graced by my awesomeness. They'd been waiting for years to come for this to happen. But the day before, they'd been waiting for me to grace the earth with my awesomeness. And people said, how about we show you a film that technically happens 3 months in the future? And the 16th of July, 1993... the world was given Hocus Pocus.
Oh, boy.
Now, the thing is with Hocus Pocus, I only just watched it today when I got home from work. And I'd never watched it before, but I'd always heard about it. And I think the thing you always talk about is the fact that it's a Halloween film. It's not too scary, don't worry. It's that kind of ooky, spooky camp scary, more than actual legit shit-your-pants scary. And of course, it features the famous singer Bette Midler. So anyway, what happens is that you have three sisters that are the Sanderson sisters.
The Sanderson sisters.
Thank you. They basically, the sisters composing of Winnie, who's played by Bette Midler. Mary, who I have no, I can't remember who played her. And of course, you've got Sarah, who's played by Sarah Jessica Parker. And
I believe it's Kathy
Najimy.
Thank you.
Basically, I found the blonde one quite hot, but the fact that when I saw the credits and found that it was Sarah Jessica Parker, I was like, yeah, I take that back. And so anyway, you start off with all the fun bits of, like, you know, the setup, where basically you have the young child, who, young girl who goes off by these witches, and then the brother tries to save his sister, but the sister dies. But instead of him, his punishment being that he dies, it's a case basically where he gets left with guilt and turns to a cat. And in this case, a black cat. Get it? Because black cats are apparently unlucky. So anyway.
His name is Zachary Binks.
Zachary Binks. Or Binks as the cat. Mm-hmm. So then we forward to, well, basically the whole witch thing starts off in 1693. And then we forward to 300 years later, 1993. Get it? Because the film came out in 1993. And so it's Halloween, and this young dude's like, oh, I did believe in Halloween. But the girl that he has the hots for believes in Halloween and stuff like that. And basically,
yeah, the girl with the yabos.
Isn't
that what you call them, Max? Yabos? Max really likes yabos.
In fact, he loves them. So they end up going to a haunted house, which was originally a museum, and it's where witches used to be. And Max, being the virgin, lights the black candle, and the black flame pops up, and the witches come back. And so, to kind of explain it, to explain it, basically the witches run amok and they're trying to become young again, so they have to try and get all the kids they can. And basically,
do you need some help with your explanation?
Yes, please.
Okay, so the idea is the lighting of the black flame candle is what resuscitates the witches. It's some sort of magic thing. But, yes, the witches 300 years ago, but after Zachary supposedly disappears, the witches were hanged, but on the promise that they would come back whenever a virgin lit the black flame candle. So to sort of help out with that bit of backstory a bit, now they're back, now it's Halloween night, and now we got three witches going around town looking for children that they can suck their life essence out of so that they can become young again. But the joke is they can't see any children because
they're all in Halloween costumes.
Mm-hmm.
Going to a completing. And then basically what happens is that the kids have to fight off the witches. And then they get their comeuppance because daylight comes along and kills them.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, witches go by vampire rules in this movie.
Yeah. And then at the end of the film, the cat dies, which is sad for most cat lovers like myself. And yes, I teared up at this film. Nothing to do with hormones or anything like that. I just teared up at the film. But it's a good thing because then Zachary Binks gets his spirit, then gets freed, and then he gets reunited with his sister and he gets to go off to heaven, and it's really sweet and everything. And I was giving the guys a rolling commentary whilst watching this through Facebook, and the best thing of all was when they go on their brooms, and the one called Mary spray it because she has a hoover, so she literally is like, literally, she rides a vacuum cleaner, and I just saw that and I thought that is hilarious. I had to tell the guys that. And so, yeah.
This joke later to be repeated on Sabrina the Teenage Witch.
Mm-hmm.
And so basically what happened...
Sanderson's did it first.
Hocus Pocus and did so it first. Then,
yeah. And so one thing I should probably talk about is the acting. I mean, Sarah Jessica Parker, this is brilliant, but like her voice is really weird because she's like, she's kind of nasally like that, but the voice is quite high. So she sounds a little bit like
that. Oh, it's heavy voice.
Yeah, I'm only destroying children, that sort of thing. And like I said, she's good looking because the hair.
Mind you, this film is her precursor to Sex in the City.
All right.
So it's only natural for her character to be boy crazy.
Well, the thing is, I kind of like didn't recognize her because her face actually had some shape. It wasn't like flat or anything. So, yeah, that's... And then when I found out it was Sarah Jessica Parker, I was like, oh, boy. But the one bit of acting I want to talk about, which is quite cheesy at the beginning, is Zachary Binks. He's like, oh, I'll save thy sister from thou horrible witches and all that stuff. And it's like, just you're trying to be Mr. Darcy. But then he's actually a bit more naturalistic when he's the cat. Mm-hmm. Ironic in a way, you know. And I have to say, the girl who plays Allison, she has that kind of vibe that reminds me of the actress who played what's-her-name in Labyrinth. And
oh, Jennifer Connelly?
Yeah, I don't know if it's like the clothing or the hair or whatever, but I thought she was quite good-looking as well, you know. There's some pretty good-looking ladies in this film, you know. And... Yeah. It's hard to explain because I only just like watched it a couple of hours ago and
I mean, did you like the movie?
Yeah, it was cheesy in some places and I just sort of think like, yeah, that was acted out a bit weird or whatever and full of cliches. But apart from that, it was a good film. I mean, you know, it was pretty much a case where I came home from work and usually at that time night, like if I'm doing a late shift, it ends about 8 o'clock in the evening, and so usually I'm like, I come home and I watch something to switch my brain off with. So I was having to like try and watch a film, but I still enjoyed it. I liked what they did with the Nina Simone song "I Put a Spell on You" by like rewriting it and making it all jazzified, and it's like putting a curse on people to like make them dance until they die. But luckily they don't die; they just end up really exhausted. And the book's a bit freaky because it's like. They're like, she's like, "Bah!" And this eye look at this, like, oh shit, the book has an eye! The book has an eye! And it's like, ah!
You need to be careful how you carry that thing, because it could just be like, okay, I'll just casually pick the little, ah, get it out of my eye! Oh, okay. Accidentally gouge the eye out with your thumb.
So yeah, it's that sort of thing. But I definitely would recommend it for like anyone who wants to get into the spirit of Halloween but doesn't want anything too scary. And also anybody who's very much into the camp dressing up side to Halloween. Because I do like Halloween, but I like the Halloween where you have all the decorations and you go to fancy dress parties and you do fancy dressing and stuff like that. That's what I kind of enjoy about Halloween. I'm not into the watching horror films and whatever, so you know.
Oh yeah.
By the way, I just want to say I apologize for this video that we talked about Hocus Pocus and not provide any sort of clips about it. at least Mike got it.
I think I know what you're referring to, but
there you go, there you go.
There you go.
But anyways, go on.
Sorry. What was I going to say? Yeah, my advice to people, if you're going to do a podcast, make sure you get some sleep beforehand. It's a good film. I would say I enjoy parts of the film, like the bit when they had to introduce the kids and the yuppie teenagers and whatever. I was like, oh, get on to it. I want to get back to the witches and that sort of thing. You know, I thought the witches were like the best part of the film.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Oh yeah, the kids are Yeah, the kids are bland, interchangeable, and forgettable. But yeah. the thing is, when typical 90s kids, I just thought of something.
I just thought of a part that I thought was brilliant, and that was the little girl. I thought she was the best. Apart from the three witches, I thought she was the best actor.
Oh, Thora Birch?
She was amazing. She was brilliant. She's like, what, 8 years old, that kid? And she's just like, she's got it. And she's just now has to get back at the bullies and like...
Mm-hmm.
She's just...
she's the only one... can protect Hollywood?
So she's, yeah, she's the only one... she's the only one who did anything with her career afterward that was remotely memorable. It was called Monkey Trouble. But in any case, yeah, this film has a cult following. We may have discussed it on this podcast before.
We mentioned it during, because a couple of years ago, Matt and Amelia at the time were talking about like Halloween related movies we can watch for kids, and we just mentioned Hocus Pocus.
Okay, well,
what do you want to be for Halloween? Drunk girl sitting on a couch watching Hocus Pocus.
You mean? So, but as far as the legacy goes with this film, it was a box office bomb in the theaters.
That's sad.
Which is odd because there's when it hit home video, that's when it really started picking up speed. And then you kind of look at it in terms of there's also the Disney Channel re-airings that happened over the years.
Every
Halloween they gotta do this movie.
When you think about it, Halloween is like something that happens in October and in the autumn or whatever. Maybe it might have been a bit more successful if it had been released in the October of 93. But instead, this film was released the day before my birthday. Maybe if it had been released in October, it might have done a bit better.
That was weird because they released that in the summer instead of autumn. I mean, that would have been a much better way to show the movie. And also, it was originally going to be a Disney Channel original movie, but the executives at Disney were like, this could be a feature-length movie for theatrical. We'll make it a full-length thing for the theaters.
And that's what it looks like. That's what it feels like, is a Disney Channel movie. But at the same time, it feels like at the very least, a watchable Disney Channel movie.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is one that it's cheesy, and well, what do you know? Kenny Ortega, the director, is the same guy who did High School Musical and
later on,
a buttload of other Disney Channel movies.
Mm-hmm.
But it sort of cemented itself over the years as a Halloween staple, and. In fact, I think 2 years ago now, there was a Hocus Pocus Spectacular at Disneyland or Disney World.
Two things. One, it's at Disney World. Two, mm-hmm. It's still going. Like, they it's had still it going. Last year as well.
They did?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, somebody... And yes, of course, they do sing the song, I Put a Spell on You, because... Quite frankly, I think that version of the song kicks ass. I never listened to the original. I will always turn on Hocus Pocus if I want the legit I Put a Spell on You.
Yeah, because the original one sounds like it was sung by a freaking madman.
It's being sung by a slow drunk. I put a spell on you. Do, 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 do. Because my...
I thought Nameless Mind did the original.
It's Screamin' Jay Hawkins.
Oh, okay.
For a moment, I was thinking it was Tom Jones.
Mm-hmm.
Weirdest thing of all is, after I watched, like, Hocus Pocus, like, I was watching, like, some sort of video on Facebook, And you know how it would like continue to the next one when the videos ended? For some reason, my phone ended up on this woman who was doing a performance of Bette Midler's Hocus Pocus version of I've Got a Spell on You.
Mm.
It's quite weird how that kind of popped up, and it was only been a little while since I like watched the film.
I believe Bette Midler also likes to dress up and perform that song in her concerts even to this day.
I'm not sure because like I think it's more of a rare occasion because I think during the like last Halloween she announced that for the last time she would wear the costume, which was something that she hasn't done in a while. Like, I don't think it's like a repetitive thing.
That could be true, but she did mention that it was her favorite movie she's ever done, and the second being the doing the voice for Oliver and Company. So she likes those two projects the most for her favorites. So just Disney films, I tell ya. They make you happy.
Can I put in a little bit of my thing on Hocus Pocus?
Sure.
Yes,
go ahead.
Please.
Go ahead, please.
Now, admittedly, I am one of those kids that actually did grew up with Hocus Pocus, not because of the seeing it in theaters or anything. It was one of those I would catch it. I actually catched it on the Disney Channel.
You grew up with it on the catch to the Disney Channel.
Yep, that also explains one of my guilty pleasures is actually Tower of Terror. But anyways. Thinking about Steve it and Cooper. Watching it now, it definitely is really campy. And of course, like the human characters per se, they're not as interesting as the Sanderson sisters. But I can actually argue that Hocus Pocus is actually a legitimately good movie. And and allow me to explain. Because the thing is, the way I see Hocus Pocus, it's kind of like it's kind of like a blend between old style Halloween and the modern Halloween, where you pretty much got the elements of the Sanderson sisters, where it's more witchcraft and it's more associated with black magic, like that kind of Halloween.
Hallows Eve.
Like Hallows Eve. And then you got the modern Halloween, which is more like partying and costumes and candy. So you got it's pretty much like a clash between these two things, and you mostly see the Sanderson sisters going around the modern era, just like trying to understand how the world around them now functions.
Mm-hmm. Very fish out of water.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's more. It's a bit like a fish out of water movie, but it features like these over the top but lovable villains. And let's be honest, this is the kind of movie where the villains like really sold it. I mean, like every single performance from Bette Midler, Kathy Najimy, and even Sarah Jessica Parker actually did a really good job at it. I can definitely understand the cult status that it got, but yeah, like for me, honestly, like I understand it's not the best Halloween movie ever, but honestly, I would go on its defense saying that, you know, it's actually a good Halloween movie. It's the kind of film that really would go and get you onto the Halloween spirit.
Can I make a point before moving on to the next? Mm. Yeah. The thing that kind of slightly bugged me or whatever, like not too much, because I was just trying to switch my brain off, but like the whole notion of black cats being evil.
Oh, like the curse, like the bad luck thing?
Yeah.
It's sad to think,
of course.
I was about to make that point, Matt. Thank you. It's sad to think that 323 years on, people still associate black cats with evil and bad luck and everything. And the fact that a sad statistic is that black cats are less likely to get adopted and more likely to get euthanized. So I know. It's like, I've had a black and white cat before, Sebastian, and we had a black cat called George, and they were absolutely loving cats, you know. And I just want to put it out there that black cats can be such loving cats and have their own unique personalities as much as any other cat. So, you know, it's I guess in a way making a stereotype that, you know, black cats are still evil because it's in theme with the Halloween thing. But like, you know, I still sort of think like, well, black cats are still lovely and whatever. I mean, if I had the opportunity, I'd go for a black cat.
Exactly. They're cats.
Yeah, and yet people don't want to adopt them because they associate them with being bad luck or evil. It's like, they're lovely, you know. I would have another black cat if I could. So yeah. If you are watching this podcast and you are thinking about getting a cat, please give black cats a chance. I mean, please, like, give them a loving home if you can. Give them a forever home. And they will repay you in kindness and cat cuddles. And
Hashtag black cats matter.
They will.
Exactly.
Exactly.
They will pay you in dead mouses.
Exactly.
Yes. Let's share this hashtag around. Black cats matter. Share it around on Twitter. It's raising awareness of black cats.
Exactly, because they're awesome. You know, they're not horrible or evil or bad luck. They are awesome. So.
I want to point out also the.
And then you're going to get. Oh, go on. Mm-hmm. Sorry.
The.
No, you go on, James.
When I was a kid, I never could realize how they got the cat to talk. Of course, now I'm watching it and saying, yeah, that's CGI, but you look at it, it's really bad.
For an early 90s movie, it's really not that bad.
For 90s, yeah, it's I give it the 90s excuse. Yeah, it's going to be a little bit it's a little bit choppy and
Hey, James, when I was a cat.
No.
Actually, I just want to say, let me just say right now that on second thought, no, the CGI on Hocus Pocus for Zachary Binks is actually just good in general. And I'm just speaking as someone who recently saw Nine Lives.
Of course.
Oh yeah,
that stupid freaking cat! I swear to God, that image will never get out of my head. That stupid cat is just like.
I love how you sat there and you were like, "Oh, do cats really do that?" And I messaged Matt saying yes, and it means this. It's like, even our human one gonna die. Wow! I actually gave him. I'm that much of a cat person, crazy cat person. I actually. Messaged him and gave him an explanation. So,
of course,
yeah.
When the Garfield movie has better animation,
and you know what,
than that movie.
I just want to mention, Steph, you're not the only one. You're not the only one who told me about that. It's like, yes, cats actually do that.
Devin?
What? No, not just Devin. Like a few people who watched that video. I think Devin as well.
You mean I wasn't the only crazy cat person?
There's other crazy cat ladies up there. Woo!
And I just want to mention about like that
Devin
whole.
If Devin had a place again, it'd be nothing but cats.
Yeah, and I just want to mention right now that I don't know if the Black Cats Matter trend could be like such. If we need to start that thing, because you're gonna get some douchebags out there that want to say that all cats matter, so that they can defend their white cats.
Or red ginger cats.
I see
cats.
Very few white cats out there. Sorry. I'm just saying. The only time I ever see a white cat is in a Tom and Jerry cartoon when Tom's stalking the girl cat. That's about it.
Did you actually see that video? Oh my god, it's actually really funny. It's like a bunch of guys just watching Tom trying to flirt with that cat and with that girl cat. Oh my god, oh, I forgot what it is, but it's like these two dudes, they were watching a Tom and Jerry cartoon where Tom is a cowboy, and like they were pretty much explaining the whole way about like what's going on. I was like oh man, he's gonna go talk to that girl. Oh man, you gotta go light up a cigarette, man. Man, look at that shit, man.
He's gonna sing some country music. Oh man.
No, that video is freaking funny.
I'm an absolute Tom and Jerry nut. How did I miss out on this video?
Oh my god, it's so good. Look it up.
Okay.
Are we done with Hocus Pocus?
Fun fact for all you people out there. Fun fact. Almost Unreal by Roxette was originally set for Hocus Pocus, but instead it went to the movie known as Super Mario Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
Which song was that?
Almost Unreal.
By Roxette.
Oh, okay.
So have you seen the Super Mario Brothers movie? That song was originally intended for Hocus Pocus, but the lead singer of that band's like, let's move it to this other movie over here.
Because they think Mario Brothers is going to be a hit.
Exactly. But here's a question I want to pose to you guys. What do you think about a sequel to Hocus Pocus?
It could be
because that was rumored, and even Bette Midler shot that down, said it's not going to happen. What would you do exactly? I mean, yeah, that's still a fun idea. And what are you going to do? The same thing that the first movie did?
I don't know. It just, there's been always been a possibility for a sequel. I mean, it always depends on the executives, you know. Hopefully, I mean, it has a cult following, so maybe there'll be an audience to give it a nice box office, you know, result, maybe, possibly, if it comes out, you know.
Yeah, like Zoolander 2.
Oh, God. The only movie that I've heard of that apparently Leonard Maltin freaking walked out of.
But in any case, I say the better follow-up would be the Disney World deal that we talked about before, because I did see that show thanks to someone who got a video and stuck it up on YouTube, and it is just so fun to see the Sanderson sisters interacting with all the other Disney villains. It's just the sort of thing that they do at their theme parks, and of course, it's a show. It's a nice little musical review show to pass the time there. Mm-hmm. It's interesting to see them all interact. Yes, Mike?
I'm poking Matt, and Matt's turn. It's Matt's turn. He's the second youngest.
Okay, well, believe it or not, guys, I'm actually offering something a little bit different. It's not going to be animation this time. I decided to look into a few, like, really, I didn't have much choice, and I really didn't feel like watching Bebe's Kids. Now, what I decided to go with was a movie that I was curious about, considering that I actually do have a little bit of a history with this movie. Well, not this movie, but the subject in particular. I decided, like, you know what, I'll feed into my curiosity and decided to check out Francis Ford Coppola's Dracula, or as it's titled, Bram Stoker's Dracula. And may I say, like, and just to give you guys a little bit of a background, even though I didn't necessarily read the book in particular...
You didn't read the book?
What?
You didn't read the book?
Oh, I will eventually. Hold on.
You didn't read the book?
Oh, I didn't read the book.
I've been calling you on all of your grammatical goofs, man. Come on.
Leave it alone, James.
Oh, you'll be doing that for a freaking while. Trust me. No, but anyways. Yeah. It took me a while to notice. I was like, what are you talking? Oh, okay. No, but anyways, I didn't read the book yet. But, I will say, though, that I have been in a couple of plays on Dracula. And even at one point, I even played the role of, like, Dracula and even Van Helsing. Ooh. So I do have a good idea of what, like, the story is about and all that stuff. And especially seeing all the different adaptations and all that kind of stuff. But going into this one, my God, it's such a huge, huge mixed bag. Because basically what this is supposed to be is that this is supposed to be like this, a big budget Hollywood Dracula movie filled with A-list stars and giant sets and all that kind of stuff. And first, let me get into some of the good things. Like, visually, it is amazing. The sets are absolutely grand. Some of the costumes actually do look nice. And even the special effects, like how they would become vampires and stuff, they actually do look pretty good. And even when Dracula is in vampire form, it's actually, you know, it actually looks nice. And admittedly, it does actually, it did actually stick a little bit closer to the book. I heard that this is one of the few adaptations that's to what Bram Stoker wrote, which is why
The title is given to Bram Stoker. Oh, God. There's the acting.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, let me start things off with what people put, like, what this thing is infamously known to be hated, freaking Keanu Reeves playing as Jonathan Harker. My God. Keanu Reeves is basically just being Keanu Reeves. He barely gets an expression out, and he barely even gets an expression, but also he barely gets an accent out. It's usually on and off, going from American to English.
you picked the right time to pick on Keanu Reeves' acting.
Yeah, especially since John Wick Chapter 2 just came out today.
And he just did a Facebook video about pineapple on pizza.
Okay, well, that's just in this movie, though. It's not his best example of acting, just saying. And then you also got freaking Gary Oldman, who actually plays four different versions of Dracula. And, like, you know, some of them are not that bad, but some of them are just way too freaking goofy. Like, when he's young Dracula and when he's vampire Dracula, it's actually pretty good. But then you get freaking old Dracula. Oh, and by the way, fun fact, this Dracula can also turn into a werewolf. And I will never forget the fact that Dracula can turn into a werewolf because Lucy would come in and suddenly she would have sex with a wolf. She was suddenly, like, Mina just goes out, and then suddenly she finds Lucy, like, having sex with a werewolf.
I think Mike just found a new favorite movie.
No, thanks.
You sure, Mike?
I'm sure.
Dracula can't be.
Yeah, and that's how Lucy turns into a vampire, by the way. But then you also got freaking Anthony Hopkins playing Van Helsing, which the best way to describe him is that take the Van Helsing character and give it the execution of frickin' Jack Sparrow. But then, and then also at the same time, you also got some costumes that look utterly frickin' ridiculous. Like, especially, I think we all know about the infamous one being old Dracula with the frickin', like, it's like in frickin' Little Nicky where he has, like, boobs on his head. Like, he has that long, like, dress shirt that's going on, and this thing won an Oscar for best hair and makeup and best costume design. It's like, what the fridge?
I think given Gary Oldman's track record on overdressing in some films, being a Jamaican white man, being Zorg in The Fifth Element, this is kind of one of those deals. You have a very committed Shakespearean actor, and no, I've not seen Bram Stoker's Dracula, but I do know some fun facts about the movie, like all the effects in the film are either practical or in camera. Which
is actually really amazing, by the way, because especially when they do the teeth, like, because you see, because originally, like, what they do is that, like, in the teeth, like, the upper gums, like, right over here, that's where, like, the vampire teeth would come out. Above the teeth, like. Right over here, that's where they would, like, it would, like, retract and then, like, come out.
And the canines?
Yeah, like, above the canines.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's actually very impressive with what they did with the visual effects. Those are really good. So, yeah, overall, I would say that, my God, this is a freaking mixed bag. Like, there is also another thing that I want to mention is that I have to admit that in terms of the way this movie is made, this has a lot of Coppola stuff on it. Like, oh my god, you can tell that it has frickin', it has Francis Ford Coppola's footprints all over the freaking place. It's like take what he visually did with Apocalypse Now times 10. Basically, you see like so many freaking transitions, and you see like things appearing on the side. Like I'll give you guys an example. Like, I'll be talking about Pokemon, for example, and then suddenly, like, what would appear here would be like Pikachu or Bulbasaur and stuff like that. And you get all these weird transitions, but it's like, it's kind of like Francis Ford Coppola really trying to push his cinematic signature on it, and like, I don't know, it feels more annoying than it does like add extra to it. Like, he needed to tone that down, but yeah, overall, I would have to say it really is such a mixed bag, because some of the elements that are good in there are great, but other elements, they're just way too goofy, and you just cannot take this thing seriously.
When you say about, like, the elements coming through, is it a bit like that kind of Brit team thing they do in Criminal Minds, when they kind of describe the crime scene, and as they do, it kind of, like, it visually comes alive, and, like, you see it as they're kind of like narrating what happened?
Yeah, a little bit.
Okay.
Actually,
there is one more thing I forgot to mention. One more thing is that I remember the most memorable thing that I've seen. It is the funniest thing, and I can't believe that nobody ever mentions it, is it's probably Keanu Reeves' most expressive scene ever, because there's actually one part where he discovers Dracula's three wives, and they were just feeding on him, and then suddenly Dracula comes in, and they all went to him because he had a baby in his arms, which is pretty much just giving them for food, like, so that the three wives would just eat that baby. And the facial expression on freaking Keanu Reeves, I swear to freaking god, he makes a face that the only way I could describe is regret going to Taco Bell, because he's just watching there like,
no, the correct response to that scene is, it's good, you can't taste the baby.
I like eating little babies. When you eat little babies, you feel good. And then at the same time, you just see Gary Oldman on the side. He's just so happy. He's just laughing at the scene. He's just like,
you gotta love Gary Oldman no matter what role he's in. He's just like, yay! Okay.
I'm gonna do a little promotion for a little somebody. Because not only our fellow co-host Morgan talked about it on Vaulting with his friend Michael Dutton. So I'll link that in below if you want to check his review of it.
Kempton, if you call him Dutton, he might kill you.
He will kill me. I'm sorry.
Lovely Kempton.
Kempton.
Okay, so here's another thing I wanted to bring up. I've been looking for this actually during the time we've been talking about Bram Stoker's Dracula.
Mm-hmm.
Ages ago I came across an article on cracked.com, which for some reason I could not search for in their damn search engine. What's the deal? let's do a little quick screen share here. There's one sequence in the film, apparently there's a traveling sequence where...
Yep. Yeah, this is the one. These are the things I'm telling you about. These are the Coppola-isms I'm telling you about that happens, like, all the frickin' time.
It's sort of looking a little bit Apocalypse Now.
Lies!
Yes. And then we got this... We got this book composited over the train shot as it's going through. Actually, yep, These are not composites. This is just people acting in front of a rear projection. But this is how this is how Coppola shoots. And every once in a while, we do this all digitally now. But every once in a while, you'll see a director want to go retro and go back to this sort of look where they use rear projections. Sometimes it works. I can't be the one to tell you how it works on this particular sequence, but Matt?
Mm-hmm.
Did that work for you, or was that just a Coppola-ism?
It's a Coppola-ism. A lot of it is just Coppola-ism. I'm telling you. Like with this movie, it can seem impressive at first, but then later it's just like, it's really pushing it. Like, there are times when you see Lucy and Mina just running around, and, like, you'll just see a shot like this where you're going to see, like, Dracula, like, looking, like, either, like, look, hold on a second, yeah, like, looking down like this, like, hey, or even just, like, on the side, he'll just be like, you know?
I don't want to sound like I'm thick, but what's a Coppolaism?
It's the director's trademark. Mm-hmm. Friends for Coppola's trademark.
Yeah, you got the Apocalypse Now eyes going on here.
Yeah.
It's basically whatever the director does in his movies. He does it repeatedly over his movies over and over and over.
Mm-hmm.
It's trademark.
Especially with freaking this one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very artsy.
Oh, yeah, like, there's being artsy and then there's just freaking pushing it.
Yeah, and pushing it is known as Godfather Part 3.
Oh, God.
Hey, hire your daughter, will you?
yes. Oh, man. Coppola, Coppola, Coppola. Yes.
Coppola is really neat. Coppola is full of meat.
That must be what Gary Oldman was singing during this movie.
Okay, so I go next after Matt, because we went from 93 to 92 to now we go to 89. And mm-hmm. for a while, I was looking at movies and there was tons to go through. I mean, 89 was a great year for movies. I mean, you have Batman, for crying out loud, with Michael Keaton. You have Ghostbusters 2 coming out that year, as well as a sequel to Back to the Future Part 2. There's so many to go through. So I want to try something different and watch a James Cameron movie that came out that year called The Abyss. Mind you, this is one of many underwater films that came out in 89. You have Deep Star 6 that came out in January of that year. You have Leviathan that came out that year. There was a couple of other like low budget ones on the side too that went on video, but that was a big year for underwater movies that year. But The Abyss was probably one of the biggest ones out there. It's got 89%, oddly enough, on Rotten Tomatoes. So 89. James Cameron's The Abyss is a deep, like, underwater deep diving movie where at the beginning of the movie, you see this submarine kind of thing, rig kind of doing its normal thing, and all of a sudden it gets crashed, and then people from a local, like, Texas oil rigging crew gets called in to rescue them. So it turns into, like, a rescue mission. And you got these, like, locals who are, like, Southerns, like, y'all here, this, I'm gonna get those these people from there, and you have Ed Harris in there. You have there's a couple other actors in there too. You have a James Cameron staple, Michael Biehn, I believe his name is Biehn. He was previously in The Terminator and Aliens. So, but he plays the bad guy in this movie. There's like a villainous subplot in this, where he has like a mustache and he's playing the villain. He's like in the crew and he has to steal like a nuclear, like, a missile from the ship that got wrecked at the beginning, and he wants to, you know, that's a subplot that just goes villainously, of course. But they go underwater. They find the ship. The ship is, like, you know, wrecked, and everybody's dead. But then they discover something different. They discover this glowy, like, jellyfish kind of alien thing. It was just, it was blue and it's glowing. You know, it's zipping around in the water. Bzz, 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 bzz. And then there's, like, a pink one that flies around, you know, like a jellyfish looking thing. It just, bzz, bzz, bzz. And it's like, what the heck is that? Is that an alien? You know, there might be aliens in the water. There might be aliens in the water. And so,
aliens in the water?
Aliens in the water? Finally, I was reading reviews of this movie, and there's, like, on Metacritic. I was reading on Metacritic, by the way. And the lowest review was, like, 28, and it was by a Christian, like, movie site. And he said it was, like, Close Encounters of the Wet Kind.
Well,
that's
in the ocean.
But I thought that was, like, a bad comparison. Like, I mean, you can't compare that to Steven Spielberg. I mean, I just thought, I mean, it's a clever title, but Jesus Christ. So then the thing, or whatever it is, we never get an explanation of what it is, but it's just, like, I guess it's aliens, I guess. So it comes, like, through the water hole that they go through under just to go outside. And it comes through, it's like this, you know, vortex of water, seawater, and it goes through, like, the rooms in the sub, you know, all the places, and then meet up with the crew. And it's CGI. This is CGI, mind you. It's CGI water. And yes, at the Academy Awards of the year, they, James Cameron and the crew won visual effects at the Oscars. Won best visual effects just because of that CGI looking alien thing. So I was like, all right, that's good. That's good. That was really good. So now they're investigating about these aliens now because the previous mission just got aborted. You know, it's all... So I watched the special edition. The theatrical edition didn't have the ending that I watched. And if you're going to watch this movie, maybe watch the special edition because it's almost like 3 hours long. And that's why it took me so long to watch it because that's almost 3 hours long.
No wonder you had to skim through the ending of it.
It just took so long. But here's the thing about it. I was invested in it. Like, the characters are the most enjoyable thing about it. Like, you get these crazy characters popping around. You got these two main leads. Ed Harris is one of them. And there's like a wife too. His wife's on board. And they're kind of like at it at most because they're separated. And now, but happy ending. They get back together again. They're like, So it's like you get character building in this with all the characters. So I was like, I was trying to get into it. But I was like, okay, I need to get this going, see what's going to happen. So they go down to see where this alien ship is or whatever the thing they're looking at. And Ed Harris goes in, you know, he just goes in the suit, and he goes in. And this jellyfish alien just goes, grabs him and goes inside the ship. You see the colors, like... There's so many colors. You look at the ship. It kind of reminds me of 2001 Space Odyssey by Stanley Kubrick. That one scene where you see all the colors come at you, and it's like magical. So Ed Harris gets to see or kind of communicate with this alien, where the alien's like, you know, your guys are wrecking the world, you know, and they have the power to end it or make it live, because it kind of shows outside where he makes a tidal wave, and the tidal wave comes by and it's like trying to threaten the human race. And Ed Harris talks it down. It's like, you know what? We'll do it. We'll take care of the planet. We're not going to do war. We're just going to be good. And then it just backs away. And at the end, they just rise back up and just happily ever after. But it's just, the movie's interesting because, like I said, the characters are good. James Cameron is known for the water work. Like, he loves, like, diving. His first directorial debut was Piranha 2. Piranha 2, The Spawning, which you can see that a lot. And that was his first movie he did. This is his fourth movie he's done. And it looks really good. Like, the blue ocean, you see, you know, the look of the ocean. It's just, the atmosphere's nice, you know, and... It's a really good movie. Nobody ever talks about The Abyss. That's the thing. When it comes to James Cameron, they talk about
Terminator and Terminator.
Titanic, Avatar. They talk about everything else, but nobody ever talks about The Abyss. And this is truly underrated for James Cameron. This is a good movie. Like, people should watch The Abyss. It's a really good. You would get absorbed into the world of it, pretty much.
You saw the ending, which blindsides its audience with by turning it into a message movie.
Exactly.
But which technically sort of shoots itself in the foot. I thought Abyss was a good movie. It was an interesting movie. You want to talk Coppola-isms? Here's a Cameron-ism for you. How about the aside from the water, which is seen in every Cameron film at pretty much to some degree. Let's talk about the the army guy is the bad guy. But so you have that cliche in there, and I'm just sort of like, well, you look at that in movies like Avatar, and you're just like, what does he have against soldiers? Exactly. But anyway, sorry.
Can I ask?
You okay?
Yeah.
Yep.
If you take a director's surname and put ism at the end, does that become the name of their technique for directing?
Yes.
Pretty much.
You take their last name and just put ism, and that's what their trademark they use in every movie they've done over the years. They put a trope in their movie.
Mm-hmm.
So.
But, Cameron has always been, to a degree, about pushing the technology in films, which it shows here.
It does.
It's good stuff. You don't have to look at it and say, oh, well, that's good for 1989. Oh, it's still pretty good.
It is. It is surprisingly still holds up. It doesn't look like, oh, God, that's late 80s, early 90s CJ. Oh, my God, get that away from me. It looks like real water. And then the floaty aliens, they look pretty darn good. It doesn't look like it's, like, out of place. It looks, like, natural in the water. It's like, wow.
I think some of the stuff in the water must have been puppetry, though.
That could have been, but mind you, Stan Winston turned down this movie and to work on another underwater movie called Leviathan. So it's just like the creature effects in that compared to CGI, it's like, wow, it's unbelievable. Mm-hmm.
And here's another thing about this film that I'm surprised you have not yet mentioned. Perfluorocarbons, or PFCs. Surely you remember the guy giving, the guy who gave the lecture about liquid breathing.
Oh, yes. I know what you're talking about. Yeah, totally. Yes. Oh, because the guy was explaining it, and one of the characters has a pet rat, and they took the rat, and it's like, don't take her, and they take him in a cage and put him in the water, but first they put the thing, and they put it in the water, and he's like, look at her, she's like, you know, getting used to it, and it's like, no, she's drowning, and so it's like, watch it, and now it breathes underwater, because it has that thing in its lung.
Yeah, liquid oxygen is an actual thing that that is used by deep sea divers. Of course, in the movie, they don't actually show them doing that to a rat. They just sort of hold it up off screen, because if you did that, you would have the animal rights people knocking on your door saying, "How did you shoot this?" But
they stayed on that shed for a while. I guess they do kind of cut back and forth, but they still show that rat do underwater.
For like a little bit. It's been a while since I've seen this movie, but in any case, yeah, liquid oxygen is something that is used by deep sea divers. The whole idea behind it is, A, it is a our bodies spend roughly 9 months breathing liquids in and out, so somehow physically we know to do this when we're in the womb and everything. And B, when you reach a certain depth at the bottom of the ocean, the air in your suit is so it's not enough to counterbalance the matter of water pressure that is surrounding you. It can crush your suit. So the idea is to fill your suit with liquid that you can breathe, so that the pressure balances out between between what would be the oxygen inside your suit and the atmosphere around you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember now, because it does pay off at the end, because one of the main characters, Ed Harris, has to be, you know, in that in order to go deeper down to see the aliens. So, and it's like, oh, it's a weird feeling, and I guess the way they communicate is you see how they talk, you see him talk through like a message on the computer, so you can't really talk while having that, so I guess it's like through the mind or something.
Mm-hmm. I ever since seeing this movie, I've always wanted to experiment with that stuff. Like, how could you get your hands on that?
I know, that's right. Yeah. So this movie has a lot of things going for it. Like, it has like so many. If you're like into like underwater movies or like diving or, you know, or something science fiction related, it's definitely a James Cameron movie you have to see. I mean, if you're a fan of The Terminator, Aliens, and his other work.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, goody. Just in time to talk about James's movie, his main movie, because we've got 30 minutes left.
Okay. Well, let's see here. Since we all picked two movies and we're going to go with one, the movie that I'm going to go with is a classic. From my birth year, 1984, we're going to talk about the movie that saved New Line Cinema from bankruptcy. Can you guys tell me what that movie was?
Nightmare
on Elm Street.
Yeah.
Yes. The original Wes Craven classic, and this movie is why I think Craven is remembered as a horror director. A lot of his other movies, now I haven't seen The Hills Have Eyes, but I've seen stuff like The Serpent in the Rainbow, that somehow they don't come close to this. And for some reason, everything in this movie sort of clicks together in terms of what makes a good horror film. The whole premise of the movie is that we have teenagers who are dying in their sleep brutally being murdered, and the one thing that they have in common is in their dreams, in their nightmares, they're having visions of a man with a creepy sweater and a burnt face, with knives for fingers, chasing them around. And no one quite knows how this is happening, but it's sort of unveiled as the film goes along that this character is Fred Krueger. A man who was a child kidnapper burned alive several years ago by the parents in the neighborhood, because he was convicted for child kidnapping and was set free by the court system somehow. So they decided to take the law into their own hands and burn this guy. But now somehow he's coming back in their nightmares, the children who should not know about him, he's coming back in their nightmares and killing them off as revenge. And what works about this film, I think, again, is that somehow they're able to create an atmosphere that is completely surreal every time that they switch over to using dreams in the film. It legit feels in some form or another like you're watching somebody's dream. And I'm always interested in movies that can do that sort of thing by tipping the scale, just sort of giving you one minor detail here and there that was really that's just off kilter enough to make something that looks realistic feel like something more than so. Or something that's not so, I should say. And the reason why I say this is a film that saved New Line Cinema at the time is because, yeah, they had other properties like Friday the 13th, which were popular, and some other, you know, teen comedies, I think, at the time. But they were facing bankruptcy. And because this movie was such a hit and got a number of sequels that got cheesier and cheesier as they went along, it was a cash cow for them. They could keep going, and that's why for a while New Line Cinema was known affectionately as the house that Freddy built.
Mm-hmm.
So another fun fact about this movie is that I happen to know someone connected to it.
Who?
Oh. I have an old friend, an old friend of mine from high school, who I still keep in contact with through Facebook. His uncle is Robert Englund.
Oh,
the man who played Freddy Krueger.
Okay.
Interesting. And the cool thing about having connections like that is, you can get signature autographs from him much, much easier, which unfortunately I never took advantage of. But hey,
being humble about it.
I knew guys once upon a time who did. And it feels like it's kind of interesting to hear him talk about it, because yeah, he goes to family events, he hangs out with Robert Englund, who's just, you know, he's an actor, he's just another guy in the family. And one of the things that he told me is that he actually took the role because he didn't want to be typecast.
Oh.
But what would he usually be typecast as?
Before Freddy Krueger, he was there was a role that he had in a TV series called V.
Oh, that show. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I know that show. I think I have V on DVD, actually.
I would be surprised if you didn't. Yes, V is a TV show about humanoid aliens who visit Earth and assimilate with our culture, sign off with our government leaders and whatnot, and they try to make this whole pact about intergalactic peace and whatnot, but no. It turns out that the aliens are actually lizard face people underneath those masks who would like to eat rats.
Mm-hmm. Oh, is that where the whole like lizard people thing came from?
Mm-hmm.
People always theorize. Oh my god! So that's where it is.
Yeah, from the show.
Yes,
from the show.
Oh my and, god! Some people freaking take that so seriously. It's crazy.
And. Robert Englund was one of the aliens on the show. He was a good guy alien.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, never give up, never surrender. For me, that's like the go-to good guy alien.
Sorry. Yeah, he was a good guy alien. He was one of the V for Victory guys rebelling against the incomers and the invaders, and this role is, when you compare it, he's very downplayed and very soft and a very nice guy and whatnot, and so he just sort of takes that and he says, I don't want to be typecast like this. So I'll just take on this role that's completely the opposite. And what do you know? He gets typecast as that for the next 20 years.
He gets another typecast. No, but funny enough, I do get where Robert Englund is going with it, because it kind of reminds me back in the days when I was doing theater. Well, yeah, when I was doing theater. And I remember I was usually typecast to always play like either the comic relief or kind of the helper, not necessarily the main character, but like more of the side characters that would help out the main character. It wouldn't be until like years later that like I felt a bit tired to like always playing like a good guy. And I decided, like, why not next time for this thing, I want to go with a villain role. And wouldn't you know it, that is the story of how I ended up playing as juror number 3 in 12 Angry Jurors.
12 Angry Men?
Yeah, 12. Well, yeah, 12 Angry Jurors, 12 Angry Men, same thing, yeah. Basically, it's
just a retitle.
Okay. Yeah, in other words, juror number 3 is the hardest guy to convince that the dude is not guilty.
Oh, you were that juror.
Yeah, that juror.
You were the guy who's like, I want to pull the switch on the kid.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow, I can't imagine you playing that.
Hey, I decided to take it on, and, you know, it was really fun. I can see me
playing that, but not you.
Oh, but it worked out very well, I must say. No, it was a really fun role, and it actually ended up making me discover what is currently one of my favorite live action movies. So amazing. I have it on Blu-ray from Criterion.
Ah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, Robert Englund, why do you must follow me around wherever I go? Seriously, on this podcast, we've talked about Robert Englund so many goddamn times. I keep bringing them up in some weird ways. Like, there was one time... Yep, two times I can think of. And there might be more. I could be wrong. But there's two times I remember. There was one time we were talking about films in the future where he was in Zombie Strippers. And then we were talking about werewolf movies. And he was in Strippers versus Werewolves. So, it keeps following me around wherever I freaking talk about movies. It's just like... Okay, well, and mind you, in 1989, Robert Englund directed a movie called 879 Death, I believe there was a horror movie directed in 89. I was like,
I'm looking it up.
876.
976 Evil.
That's what it was. Thank you. Because I was like, should I talk about that movie? It's like, oh, Robert Englund. And just like, nah. So yeah, he just follows me around when I talk about movies. But yeah, Nightmare on Elm Street is really one of the pinnacle 80s horror movies out there. And also, Johnny Depp's film debut in this.
Mm-hmm.
He freaking dies in bed in a pool of blood.
As one of the most epic death scenes in the film.
It's all because it was Johnny Depp in it. He died for your sins.
There's also, you're also forgetting something else. Robert Englund directed two episodes of the spin-off show Freddy's Nightmares.
Of course, because he is Freddy Krueger after all.
Yes.
Could you imagine freaking Robert Englund, like, entirely in his Freddy costume, just directing people around?
All right, you bitch, go over there. You gotta read off your line.
All right, bitches, places.
It's weird because...
Do it like you did it in audition, bitch. Come on.
It's funny in the movie...
I want to hear you scream.
In the movie, the character of Freddy has only, like, screen time of under 7 minutes. So you don't see him as much in the movie. Which is...
Yeah.
Usually, you know, he's longer in the movies. There's some interesting facts, like, about the glove... Like, Robert Englund got cut when he first tried it on. There's, it was funny because in Nightmare, you see a glimpse of the TV and he's showing the Evil Dead. And so in Evil Dead 2, you can see in one scene in the movie, Freddy's glove is in the scene. So it's kind of back and forth between Wes Craven and Sam Raimi. And then and then when they try to return it back for, Nightmare 3, they lost it, and they could never find it ever since.
Oh, so Sam Raimi probably has the glove somewhere.
It could be. It's still a mystery. That glove is just, you know, floating somewhere. The original glove. But yeah, it's, man, Freddy, he gave me nightmares. He was a boogity-boogity man. I think my brother dressed up as him for Halloween and scared the shit out of me. So I have associated with Nightmare.
So that's your relationship with Nightmare on Elm Street?
Yeah, so many. Just put the mask on. Hey, bitches!
He's a good boogeyman for the span of films that they made the character on.
I wouldn't want to be killed by him. Oh my god. The ways he gets killed. People gets killed in this movie, my lord.
It's so drawn out and so.
I think like he's... people really do appreciate the creativity that goes into the killings. Like especially when you're in a dream, like you go all out on that thing.
Exactly.
And sometimes it can be. Sometimes well, actually, with the later films, sometimes it could actually be kind of. It wasn't just creative, but it was also kind of funny at the same time. Like, right.
Well, especially because... with his one-liners.
Oh yeah.
It was either, welcome to prime time, bitch.
Yeah, welcome to prime time, bitch, and shoves her in the TV. Oh, and doesn't he have like a power glove in one of them? It's like, now I'm playing with power.
Yes.
Yeah. Actually, one of the best ones I remember was when the one kid who's a comic book lover falls asleep and turns into a comic book illustration, like something out of Take on Me, and he goes into the dream world. He's got this persona on where he's Captain Macho or something like that, and he shoots Freddy Krueger, but Freddy Krueger comes back wearing a cape and just goes, more powerful than a loco madman, it's Super Freddy. Slash.
That actually sounds amazing.
The longevity and the legacy of Nightmare. Oh my god, so many good things, so many bad things, but it all started with the A4 classic.
And here's another thing. I believe around the early 2000s, he was at Robert Englund was actually retired, or trying to retire, but guess what pulled him out?
Freddy vs. Jason.
He came back into acting just for that, and somehow he's not quite retired since then either.
You know, there is actually a movie that I've heard about that's in production, and I think it's directed by Tom Savini, and what they're trying to do is, from what I've heard, it's like, they say it's the Expendables of horror movies, where it's not like, they're not really bringing in, like, actually Freddy or Jason or stuff like that, but they're actually bringing in the people who have played, like, Freddy, Jason, Michael Myers, and all those people, and, mm-hmm. like, to have them in a horror brawl.
I've heard about that. That's been floating around for a while. That'd be interesting, though.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Hey, I mean, well, who else would we get in there? Doug Bradley, Kane Hodder.
Yeah.
Bruce Campbell.
Tom Savini, like I said.
Yeah. So it'd be interesting to do that.
I'll be directing, I'll be acting in the movie, man, and then I'll be doing the makeup effects, too.
All that stuff in a bottle of the Robert. Well,
see whatever comes of that.
Yeah, let's see. Robert Englund. We did tell a story in the podcast one time where Robert Englund actually influenced Mark Hamill to be Luke Skywalker in Star Wars.
Hmm? What?
Yeah.
I don't remember that story.
Oh my god, really? There's at the time in the 70s, I believe Mark Hamill was like staying at Robert Englund's place. And Robert Englund kind of like nudged him, like, "Hey, you should go do Star Wars. Just do Star Wars."
Why would you not do Star Wars?
So he was just there. Hey, look, Star Wars. Do it.
Do Star Wars, bitch.
Let me see if I looked that up actually, because I remember. Here we go. Give me a second here. Where are we at here? Okay.
Steph, you haven't said anything about Nightmare on Elm Street.
She probably hasn't. She hasn't seen it.
Okay.
And then I went...
I don't think she's in the pink.
And then I went home and told a little kid that was sleeping on my couch after a six-pack of Heidegen all about Star Wars, and his name was Mark Hamill. I said, "Hey, Lucas is doing this space movie. Maybe you're right for it. The lead guy's like a teenager." So Mark got on the phone to his agent, and I think he went up the next day. He nailed it, and the rest is history.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
It's all because of...
Sorry, I didn't realize we were still talking about Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yeah, we're still on the subject of Robert Englund.
Yeah, she wants to go visit Freddy.
Mm-hmm.
She's about to. She might get haunted by Freddy.
Or if she wants to go, if she doesn't want to be threatened by copyrights, she'll be haunted by Scary Terry.
Scary Terry.
Scary Terry?
You never see. You don't know that episode of Rick and Morty?
Oh, man. Of course. So many copyrights.
Now I remember Scary Terry, the one with the balls on his chin, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's Scary Terry, right. No one cares about your bullcrap about Inception, Morty. It's completely different. Okay, now I remember the episode.
Man, yes. Any final words before we wrap up this episode? Ah!
Yes! That's Scary Terry.
Yes, there we go, folks. Scary Terry for you.
You're welcome.
Okay, we have a minute left, and I think I should wrap it up because that's all we need to talk about. I mean, what else is there to talk about? Nightmare. I mean, it's a classic.
Yeah. I guess if we have 7 minutes left, can I briefly dabble into one thing about my alternate choice?
Sure, you can go on.
I'm gonna end. Why not just end on me saying something controversial here and starting off a little conversation?
You better come on, bring it.
Okay. Why is the Karate Kid so popular? Why was it so popular?
Wax on, wax off.
It has, in the early 80s, maybe in the late 70s, there was the sports movies, and Rocky was the start of it, and the Karate Kid had that spirit of the sports movie. It had a great soundtrack, it had elements of the underdog rising to the top, beating memorable bad guys, memorable like the Cobra Kai, the group, and you have Johnny. Oh my God, Johnny is the ultimate like 80s bully. Like, and then you have the Karate Kid. You know, karate is a very popular thing.
No, really?
Yeah, really.
Because I remember always. Even as a kid, when I was at the around the time when I was at the age where this sort of movie is supposed to appeal to you, I never quite got into it. And I got into it over the years, but when you say yeah, you are pointing out Rocky, and you have a good reason for that because it's the same director.
Yeah,
but I guess. Yeah, the Rocky films as a whole, I always found to be a lot more of an interesting franchise. This is the same formula, only boiled down for kids, and somehow out of all the formulaic sports movies, this was one that became iconic. So I'm just curious, you know, what's the secret of that? How does that work? Is it just a chance that
Or you know what it could be? You know what it could be? Mm-hmm. Karate. That's the big thing, is that because some people are interested into karate, and I mean, when you think about it, there really isn't a lot of like karate movies. Yes, there's kung fu, but there isn't one that looks specifically into karate. And consider, and like, keep in mind, like a lot of kids, when they would grow up, they want to go and do a lot of like, they want to go and try to train in some martial arts in a way.
They always go to karate.
Yeah. So Karate Kid in a way kind of serves as like an inspiration. So they want to, you know, like to pretty much learn the ways from like the what's the name of the master in there?
Mr. Miyagi.
Mr. Miyagi, yeah, like they want to learn
the train. Yeah, they want to train the ways of
Mr. Miyagi.
Mr. Miyagi. Yeah, of Mr. Miyagi. So that could be one explanation. It's the factor of karate, and
I can understand where you're coming from, James. I think the problem you're having with is the character of Daniel LaRusso. Like, I don't Rocky, you want to root for. Daniel LaRusso, however, he comes from New Jersey, goes to California, and becomes this new kid, and he gets bullied around by Cobra Kai, you know, and he falls in love with Elizabeth Shue. I don't remember her character's name is, and then he gets.
Who doesn't fall in love with Elizabeth Shue?
I mean, Elizabeth Shue. I mean, and then he hooks. He, you know, gets associated with Mr. Miyagi, which I think he's the most memorable part of the movie. Like, he, that's why it's so quotable, like, wax on, wax off. I mean, even Turtles 2, Secret of the Ooze, reference Karate Kid. It's like, wax on, wax off, wax on, wax off.
What's the... And I guess the joke is sort of, oh, well, he sort of taught him the karate moves just by having him do day-to-day chores.
And that's kind of ingenious, I guess, in a way, because you can try to teach karate the formal way, but this is a way for him to, like, have that in his mind. Like, he's like, wax on, wax off, and then he's, like, painting the brush, painting, 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 you know? It's just, like, it's associated that easily, you know, as a karate move.
So I guess in a way you could say that it has a bit of a cheesiness, mm-hmm, where you gotta do, like, do your chores and, like, you'll learn karate.
Mm-hmm. It's,
I must be doing something wrong then, because I'm checking groceries at Target and I haven't learned any special skills yet.
You're just not, I don't know, I never know.
Here's your receipt. Good day.
Receipt on, receipt off.
Doot, 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 doot. I don't know.
This one we call, would you like red card?
Yeah, I mean, like, it has a great soundtrack. It's an 80s soundtrack. I mean, you have You're the Best Around, which was actually a supposedly... That was originally for a Rocky movie, but they actually said, oh, hey, we'll use it for The Karate Kid.
And then we're going to switch up Roxette for another movie, too.
It's, yeah, I think it's a really good movie. Like, that's one of my favorites, actually. It's a good story, you know, underdog story. And a lot of people say, oh, hey, the Cobra Kai, Johnny is the winner of it all. Daniel LaRusso's the bad guy. So there's, like...
Yeah, because they do point out that technically, by doing the crane kick, he should be disqualified.
Exactly, but... Of course,
technically, but let's give the kid a chance.
Yes, yay! He wins! He knocks him out! Woo! I mean... The first movie was good. The second movie, Karate Kid 2, was good. 3 and the next Karate Kid. And the remake, don't even discuss about the remake. Oh my god, that's not even karate, it's freaking kung fu.
We will teach you kung fu by putting on a coat. It's even less natural or less muscular than waxing your car, but...
Okay. It's less stupid when you don't think about it.
And it's a role that was given to Jaden Smith for his birthday.
Yeah.
Because daddy.
Oh, thank you, daddy.
Nah. I actually don't know if that's true. It's just a joke that I made up. Yeah, but anyway.
Yeah, so that is it, folks. That is the podcast. This is a nice little revisit to our birth year, talking about films of our birth year. Comment below what your birth year is and what films came out in that year. Thank you for watching. Of course, James, Matt, and Sleepy Steffi over there was part of the podcast. Next time, we're going to talk about the composer known as Danny Elfman.
Oh, boy.
So we get to pick out a movie of Danny Elfman and talk about his music of the movie.
Can I talk about the Simpsons theme? Just do that.
Sure, you can talk about. It'd be really short, though.
Yeah.
Sure.
It's all these different variations over the years, but.
We'll probably mention it. You know, anything.
Could be possible. I actually got a crazy idea for it already. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna make my reservations like right after this after we wrap up this one.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. So thank you for watching. Please click the like button if you enjoyed this episode. Make sure you subscribe to both James, Matt, and especially Steph if you'd like to see more of their content on their own YouTube channels. Other than that, I can recommend you the the original films over Birth Year, and check out some other stuff on my channel. I got other stuff. I got more episodes of the podcast. I'm doing interviews now. I have editorials. Check everything out on my channel and subscribe. Subscribe for more content. Thank you, and long live cinema. Goodbye.
Ciao for now.
So dramatic.